Okay, so essays due tonight. I'm gonna do my very best to get them all back to you in the next 2 weeks. So 2 weeks from tonight is my deadline to get them back to you with as many comments as I can give you. And then after that, the next thing is a test in the end of July, sort of like late July. Yeah.
Is the test gonna be just on stuff like after test one?
That's right. So it's from test one to test two, that block is what we're gonna do.
And then the exam is like on
it? Yeah, yeah. With some emphasis on the latter part of the post-test two stuff. The only difference between test two and test two has fewer short answer and one essay question. We'll talk about what that is. And the essay question, if you thought that the short answers on the first one were fairly like, oh yeah, I remember this idea of this thing, because I tried to pick large topics from the course, the essay questions will be even larger topics. So very hard to misfire and not study something that's gonna be in the essay question. It'll be something to the effect of summarize all the stuff we've been talking about. Something like that. Anyway. Okay. Anything else? All right, let's review. Okay, so it's been a while. We should talk about where we've been and what's going on. So we're in AI, right? And we've been talking about the history of AI. We finally made it all the way up to the 20th century history of AI, which is probably a relief to some of you. We've been talking about what's called the good old fashioned approach to AI, GoFi. The GoFi project basically starts when electronic computers show up on the scene and continues pretty much until the 1990s. Like, this was the paradigm in cognitive science, and as cognitive science became a thing, this was the paradigm. And it was a really, this is Jerry Fodor, sort of one of the godfathers of AI, or not AI, of cognitive science. He called this the only game in town. And I think you can see why it might have been the only game in town, because it was this really appealing package of ideas. Really, really nicely fit together. They fit together with what we know about the mind. They fit together with the technology that we had available. So on the one hand, you've got things like this computer versus, suddenly we've got computers. So, oh, maybe the mind is like a computer. That means that it's possible to instantiate a mind on a computer. Like if your mind works like a computer works, that is, it's computational, then you can build a computer that has a full-blown mind. And that's sort of like a very nice hope for artificial intelligence. It also gave us, so that's the like potential for AI, sounds really nice. It also gives us an answer to this mind-body problem. So the question of how does the mind relate to the body? This is a thing that's been an issue since Descartes, and the good old-fashioned AI picture on the computer metaphor gives us a really nice answer. It says the mind is like the software running on the hardware of the body, the brain. So if your mind is like software, that tells you that there's nothing mystical about software, right? There's nothing otherworldly or non-physical about the software on your laptop, but nonetheless, it's not just a matter of what the hardware is doing, in the sense that the same software could go on many different computers with many different chip designs. So it's a way of preserving the idea that there's a difference between mind and body, but not having that difference be so radical as to be that the mind is like a ghost stuff that haunts your body until the day of your death, at which point it floats off into Plato's heaven or God's heaven or whatever. So it's a kind of middle ground. It's a middle position between the reductive, like you don't have a mind at all, and the dualist who says that your mind is a totally separate kind of stuff. So that's nice. The computer metaphor gives us hope for AI. It gives us a picture of how the mind and body are related. It gives us what we're talking about this in terms of medium independence. So if the mind is like a formal system, if it works like a computer, then the mind is medium independent. It could be realized in many different media. And therefore it's multiply realizable. And we talked about how you need if we're gonna get AI, you need for the mind to be multiply realizable. It has to be the case that you can have a mind in stuff other than just human brains, right? So, really appealing package. Really, really exciting sort of proposal that, and we talked about the kind of methodological benefits of this as well, right? So if the mind is like software running on the hardware of your computer, then you psychologists and cognitive psychologists don't really have to know much about the brain, do you, to proceed on your project of learning about the mind? Because that's like trying to understand Microsoft Excel by looking at how the chips in your laptop are built. Maybe it could help theoretically, possibly, but you really don't need to, do you? You can just go ahead and study the software, understand how the software works, and that's your job, right? You're done. So methodologically, that's nice because they really didn't have very much access to what's going on in the brain in the sense of, in a functional sense. Like you could look at cut up slices of brain after the person is deceased, but you couldn't see the brain in action in the 60s. Now we can see some of the activity of the brain, but that was really inaccessible. So methodologically, this is a really nice proposal as well. And we'll talk about this in a couple, maybe next week. This has answers to some really deep problems, some really deep questions about how we are able to do the things that we're able to do. So for example, just to preview a little bit, if you understand the phrase, the goat is on the mountain, you also understand the phrase, the goat is not on the mountain, right? That seems to be a really systematic fact about us, that you can understand the goat is on the mountain and not on the plain, right? So you can combine ideas together in this logical combinatorial way, and thinking about the mind as a formal system immediately predicts that we should be like that. Whereas some of the other proposals we look at don't seem to have that as an automatic consequence. So this view has got a bunch of stuff going for it. It's got a really appealing metaphysics, that is the relationship between mind and body. It's got a methodologically appealing picture. It makes the mind studyable in deep, deep ways and provides hope that AI is going to, it's just right around the corner, you guys. AI is right around the corner. It's 1972 and we are just on the cusp of any day now, AI is coming. So it was this very exciting research program, this very compelling picture of how cognitive science is gonna develop. That should sound very ominous to you. All right, so GoFi, good old-fashioned AI. We're gonna continue to talk about that today. And today we're gonna kind of continue to expand a definition of a computer that we started looking at before the break. So before the break, this is from John Haugland's book, Artificial Intelligence, Very Idea. The mind is an a computer is an interpreted automatic formal system. So what we did last time before the break was formal system. So we talked about what it means for a system to be formal. And today we're gonna talk about a little bit about interpreted and automatic. So that's the plan for today. When we were talking about formal systems last time, we talked about types and tokens. You remember this stuff about how in a formal system, there are a bunch of tokens, the pieces that are moved around, and they are identified only by their type. So nothing about this person on D2, lots of stuff about the matters to them, of course, to their family and friends, but in terms of them being a piece on a chessboard, the only thing that's relevant is, are they a pawn or not? So because they're a pawn, that completely determines their role in the formal system, right? There's a bunch of other facts that are true about them. They have a life history, they have a rich inner life, all that stuff. But in terms of the formal system, the only thing that matters is the type of the token. And that's part of what makes it a formal system. So solve, we're calling all this stuff. Okay? And one of the things that formality provides us that it guarantees is self-containedness. That is, a formal game or a formal system more generally is self-contained, just in case there's nothing about the rest of the universe that matters in terms of the internal dynamics of the game. Its inputs matter, so if you move a chess piece, that matters to the internal dynamics of the game. But if you're playing chess, it doesn't matter if you're in the International Space Station. It doesn't matter what day of the week it is. Nothing about the rest of the universe matters, right? To determine what can happen inside the game, what's allowed at least by the rules to happen inside the game. So, another way of saying this, the meaning of the rule moves is irrelevant. So, the only thing that determines what's allowed to happen inside the game are the rules that determine what the various tokens of type of certain types are allowed to do. Right? So, if it's a pawn, you're allowed to move one or two spaces forward, and that's it. There's nothing about the significance or meaning of the move that makes any difference to the way that the game goes. It's kind of the irrelevance of everything except for what's internal to the game. Whereas most of our interactions don't have this self-containedness, right? You have a conversation with somebody, the rest of the universe matters, right? Like, what day of the week it is, whether they're awake or not, whether there are nuclear bombs falling outside, and it's the end of the world. Those things all matter to the conversation you're going to have with them, right? So that's not self-contained. We're open to the world, right? We're interacting densely in a contextually sensitive manner to our environment. Whereas in a formal system, that's kind of like, no, we don't care about that. Say, well, can't I move my pawn three moves ahead because we're in space and the world just got nuked? Say, no, that doesn't matter at all. The system is self-contained, right? Okay, and that gives us medium independence, which is, we just talked about this, how you can have the same formal system instantiated in very different media. So you can play chess on computer, you can play it with wood, you can play it with marble, you can play eccentric billionaire helicopter chess. Like, these are all the same game. You know, very unlike playing most sports, I think any sport, where if you switched out the ball for like a concrete sphere, that's not the same game anymore, right? It's not the same game. If you switch out full-size soccer players for foosball, it's a different game. So the identity of the game depends very much on the physics of the thing rather than just the rules. In a formal system, it's medium independent because so long as you can instantiate the rules, it's the same system. And that gives us one way to get multiple realizability. So because it's medium independent, it's multiply realizable, which gives us some hope of someday getting AI going. I want to remind you that that's not the being formally equivalent. So being a formal system that's medium independent is one way of getting multiple realizability. It's not the only way. We talked a little bit about multiply realizable self-organizing dynamical systems. That's another way of being medium independent, or being multiply realizable is just being the same kind of phenomena in different physical matter. So this is part of the only game in town story was this is the only obvious way at the time that people could think of to get multiple realizability is to be a formal system. Okay, we have reviewed. I think that's as far as we got. Questions, confusions? Okay, so new stuff. Let's talk about digitality and automaticity. So I'm gonna use this word in a weird way. Almost all of you probably think of digitality as being about ones and zeros, and that's not what I'm gonna mean here. So I'm gonna follow Haugeland, who gives this very specific definition of digital systems, and it's an important set of properties. So he says, a digital system is a set of positive and reliable techniques for producing and re-identifying tokens or configurations of tokens from some pre-specified set of types. Ah, so clear. Now it's clear. Okay, so we're gonna go through this bit by bit, all right? So there's the whole thing, and I'm gonna go through it bit by bit, and we'll come back to the whole thing, and then it'll make sense, hopefully, yeah? Okay, so let's talk about positive and reliable technique, shall we? What are we talking about? It's not just a technique that you feel good about. A positive technique is a technique where you can succeed completely. So it's about the degrees of success, right? So Compare, for example, playing golf, where it either went in the hole or it didn't, right? There are positive techniques in the sense that if anything that gets the golf ball in the goal state is equally good, right? Another positive technique. There are positive techniques for counting the people in this room right now, right? You could achieve 100% success in trying to determine how many humans are in this room, right? 100% success. It's not just sort of successful. Compare that to going on a good date, where I don't think that there is such a thing as 100% success in that case. You succeed by degrees in many of the parts of it, right? Write a good novel. There's no 100% mark on novels, right? There's no like, that was the perfect novel. No, there's good, there are better or worse novels according to better or worse criteria. But first, if there's a positive technique, that means that you can succeed all the way without any reservation. Now notice that having a positive technique doesn't mean that you get it right all the time. For example, counting people in a room, I can't tell you how many times I've watched graduate students running an exam, and they say, okay, you count how many people and you count how many people, and they come up with different numbers. The most educated people in our society often fail to come up with the correct number of people in a room. It's harder than it looks, actually. So there is a positive technique in the sense that you could completely succeed. That is, you're either completely right about the number of people in the room or you are wrong. However, that doesn't mean that you've necessarily got a reliable technique. So, yeah?
So if I'm writing an essay, does it become a positive technique once it's written?
Well, okay, so whether something is a positive technique is relative to a criterion of success. So if you personally have a criterion of success, I will get a pass on this essay, then you can either 100% pass or 100% not pass. So if that's your criterion of success, then there are positive techniques for writing a passing essay. Whereas if your question is like writing a good essay, then I don't think that there's a positive technique for that, because there's no way to succeed without any reservation. Yeah. So it's very much relative to criteria of success. Like if you in basketball, if you shoot a basket, if it goes through the hoop and you didn't commit any fouls or anything, you get the points. That's positive in that sense. Your coach might say, well, your technique wasn't, even if you got the basket, your coach might say, well, even your technique was a little off, you know, you could have shot a little earlier, your form could have been better. So with a different set of criteria, the same action could be maybe not have positive evaluation criteria, but relative to a set of criteria, if you can succeed without reservation, completely succeed, then it's a positive thing. That is the positive technique, yeah? And of course, you can completely succeed in getting a hole in one in golf, which doesn't mean that you can do that regularly. So distinguish having a positive technique from having a reliable technique. So a technique is reliable if it has a high probability of success, right? So that's relative to two things, both what you mean by success and what you mean by high probability. Ironically, I picked this image of regulating the temperature in the room because, as everybody knows, it's pretty easy to regulate the temperature of a room in comfortable levels, especially if you're at the Ivy League of Canada, where you take care of our students, paying thousands of dollars to be frozen mildly. So typically speaking, we have fairly reliable techniques for keeping a room at room temperature, right? Fairly reliable. Within some range. There's a thermostat in the room, and that measures like at one point what the temperature is. You wouldn't measure every single atom of space in the room and make sure that it's reliably exactly at 68 Fahrenheit or whatever, or 23 Celsius. You wouldn't sort of like make your success criteria that narrow. But if you say keeping a room at approximately room temperature, I think you can say there are very reliable techniques. That is, there are techniques that succeed with very high probability at doing that, usually. So case in point, we need to define high probability. We need to define what we mean by getting it right most of the time. But it's given a definition of success, given a definition of high probability, we can say that there's some technique is reliable if it succeeds with a high probability. All right? Okay, so go quickly back to our definition of digitality. So it's a system of positive and reliable techniques. So techniques that can succeed completely and that are reliable at doing so for doing the following: for re-identifying tokens or configurations of tokens from some pre-specified set of types. So, and this is why positive and reliable techniques are important in formal systems. That is, they help generate the self-containedness, which we just talked about. So the fact that a technique is positive ensures that, so when your computer is reading and writing things off its hard drive, there are micro fluctuations, right? There's tiny little fluctuations in how each individual read cycle, write cycle goes. Sorry, reading and writing. Digital system is a set of read-write techniques that are positive and reliable. Reading and writing just means manipulating the tokens in the system, right? So another set of words that I'm going to use in a slightly odd way. I take it this is fairly, you all know at least enough about computers to know that they read and write to their hard drives, yeah? And that doesn't baffle you. They're not like, oh, my computer's understanding what's on the hard drive. So reading and writing, simply a matter of manipulating the tokens. Okay, so thinking about, try to see how this relates to self-containedness. The fact that, you know, yes, the what's going on with the sunspots right now has a micro influence on how your computer is behaving. Very, very tiny variations of electromagnetics are affecting the, as a matter of physics, are affecting every piece of software, hardware in the world. But because the techniques that they're using are positive and reasonably reliable, those variations don't add up to a difference, right? They don't add up to anything that makes a difference within the formal system that your computer is running. So this is how having techniques that are positive and hopefully reliable is how the formal system isolates itself from the rest of the universe. It has its own internal dynamics that don't depend on what's going on everywhere else in the universe. Does that make sense? Okay. So, here we are. I'd like to make the, so this is digitality in a something somewhat odd sense. It's digitality in a sense where a Shakespeare sonnet is digital. So consider the following. The thing on the right, I believe it's a Rembrandt painting. The thing on the left is a Shakespeare sonnet. Over time, inevitably, all of the Rembrandt paintings are going to go away. At some point in the future, there won't be any more Rembrandt paintings in the world. Because we identify the Rembrandt paintings not just with the, this is obviously a projection of a reproduction of a Rembrandt painting, right? I didn't bring you a Rembrandt to look at today. I'm showing you a reproduction of a Rembrandt. The real Rembrandt is identified with certain collection of brush strokes, which are not digital, right? Those are not digital. Those are like a physical object in the world. And slowly, inevitably, over time, those physical objects are going to go away by happenstance or just a slow degradation of time. However, the Rembrandt or the Shakespeare sonnets might last a really long time. There's no limit on how long they can last, because we don't identify the Shakespeare sonnet with the specific first time he wrote it down, right? It's the collection of letters in that order that makes it the sonnet. So this is plausibly, I don't know if they translated this a little bit. I think they just leave them original, right? So this is plausibly the exact sequence of letters that Shakespeare wrote down, like reproduced exactly. And there's no degradation over time. Well, potentially there's no, I mean, of course there are some that you can fail to have positive and reliable reproduction techniques, but given positive and reliable reproduction techniques where the standards are keep these letters in this order, you could continue to reproduce this thing forever.
But wherefore do not you, a mightier way, make war upon this bloody tyrant time and fortify yourself in your decay with means more blessed than my barren rhyme.
So this is digitality. Digitality in a broad sense, not in the sense of ones and zeros. Digitality in the sense of being identifiable with a set of tokens of a particular type, which is true about the sonnet, not true about the Rembrandt. The Rembrandt is a unique individual, right? It's a specific physical individual. If you see a reproduction of it, you don't buy it for millions of dollars. You say, ah, that's a nice reproduction, but you don't say that's the Rembrandt painting. So, and notice how this is achieved, of course. We stipulate that a whole bunch of different instances count as the same thing. This is one of the great sort of challenges of early AI was reading our handwriting. So we just say that you can write the letter D in a whole bunch of different ways and that they all count as equivalent instances of the letter D, right? So accepting like minor variations as equivalent. By the way, on your tests, I don't think I ever found any part of your writing legible. So I managed to read all of your text. I don't think anybody, I would have, if I found something illegible, I would have underlined it and written illegible under it. So if you don't see that, that means I was able to read all of your writing using top-down and bottom-up processing. Okay, so this is how we achieve digitality. We just sort of stipulate that very slightly different things count as the same thing. So this is why that stuff about stipulating what counts as success matters quite a bit. Yeah, and this is what digitality is what sort of helps generate and preserve self-containedness. It's what helps generate and preserve medium independence. So by stipulating that things are the same thing or like close enough to the same thing, the kind of minor variations that appear in the medium can be made to be irrelevant, right? So one person's laptop is going to be affected by slight variations in background electromagnetics, different than somebody else's laptop, but because they are digital systems that sort of robustly cancel those differences out, you can run the same formal system. Yeah? Okay, so this is how we get digitality. Hausdorff also specifies that these things should be finitely playable, which is just to say that you can run the formal system without any, quote, infinite or magical powers required. That is, that they can be played by a finite agent. They can be built, they can be constructed in a finite machine that runs in finite time. It's not that strong of a constraint, just sort of another bit of this. I say that it's not that strong a constraint, but then we talked a lot about combinatorial explosion and how like that's a serious constraint on how we can be built as machines. So just that they should be finite turns out to be a hard thing to satisfy. Anyway. Right. And they should also be rule governed. This is a bit odd, a bit subtle, but I think it's worth talking about a little bit. So distinguish two different types of systems that are rule described versus systems that are rule governed. So the solar system is clearly describable by physics, and
you know, the laws of physics sometimes involve doing calculus, right? So you can use calculus to describe how the solar system is moving. That doesn't really mean that Mars is doing calculus though, right? It's not working through integrals and differentials, or sorry, I'm trying to fake a knowledge of calculus. It's not doing calculus, but it is describable in terms of calculus. Yeah. So that's a rule described system, but it's not really, it's not calculus that's moving the planets around. Distinguish that from rule governed systems, systems which actually are doing what they do because of the way the rules are. So a rule governed system can tell which moves are legal and chooses moves based on that fact. Right? So it's responsive to the rules in some important way. If you have a pet rock, you say sit, it just sits there. You say stay, it just stays there. It's not really rule governed in this sense, right? It was gonna sit there and it was gonna stay no matter what happened. It's not sensitive to what the rules are or why the rules are, and making decisions based on what the rules say, in just the same way that the planet Mars isn't doing calculus. So Haugland wants these, so what part of the definition of this, of a computer in the sense of Haugland's like good old fashioned AI stuff, is that the system should be rule governed in the sense that it's got some representation of what the rules are built into it, and it's acting according to those, that representation of the rules. It's trying to follow the rules. One way of thinking about this is that a rule described system can never make a mistake. There's no sense in which the solar system can mess it up. Oh, I forgot to carry the 3 and Mars isn't where it's supposed to go. That's not how rule described systems works. Whereas a rule governed system can make a mistake. You can have a bug in the system where it fails to follow the rules that it's in some broad sense trying to follow. Okay? Okay. Okay, so that's the basics of his definition. I think there's one more part to his definition, but we'll get to that in a little bit. We've got enough on the table now to talk a little bit about how such a system could both be satisfy the naturalistic imperative that is contained no homunculi, and yet do stuff that looks intelligent, right? So the point of this is, of course, to build a machine out of unintelligent parts that eventually does stuff that looks intelligent or is intelligent in some deep sense. So how do we get there? How do we get from completely unthinking processes to thinking, actual thinking? That's what's going to satisfy the naturalistic imperative. That's what's going to, if you recall this debate between Descartes and Hobbes, that's what's going to beat Descartes' objection. So Descartes says, how are we going to do meaning? How are we going to do reasoning? How are we going to do all this stuff, that this mental stuff, if the system is just made of physical mechanical parts? And the GoFi answer to that question is basically, well, we're going to start from really simple stuff, put it together in a way that it ends up being something complex and intricate and smart. So a formal system is built out of the simplest operations it can it can perform positively and reliably. All these, it was the 80s, so we called it primitive operations. I bet they pick a different word these days, but that's what they called it. So these primitive operations will be algorithmic in the sense that they will, so this is a, what kind of gate is this? Is that an OR gate? Yeah? It's an AND gate. Okay, so this is an AND gate. If you get true for A and true for B, you get true coming out for Z. And if you get any other configuration, it comes out false, right? So that's an algorithm. It says, it tells you what to do given any set of possible inputs, what to do on the output, right? So perfectly algorithmic. And you might be thinking, yes, but you told me that the mind can't possibly be algorithmic, Corey. You went on and on about it. You were very insistent. And that's right. So at the level at which we are thinking, we can't possibly be using algorithms. You can't play chess algorithmically. You can't make a sandwich algorithmically.
That's right. But the proposal here is that we are made out of algorithms, but that we enact things that are not algorithmic. So you put enough of these things together, they can behave in a way that's not algorithmic. So you have to have, you need to do this, you need to have some flexibility in the system. You need to be able to say, if this thing happens, then do that. If that thing happens, then do this. So a formal system has these conditionals, they're called, so if-then statements. Those can also be perfectly algorithmic. So if it has primitive operations and the ability to handle conditionals, then Haugen calls it a primitive algorithm. And out of those things, you can put together a whole bunch of them and build something complex, which doesn't act like an algorithm, which acts like an intelligent, something reasonably intelligent. That's the plan, that's the idea. So that's how you get, that's how you both satisfy Hobbes. You could say, look, this system is purely algorithmic at its root, at the bottom level, but not at the level at which it's performing, not the level of which it's acting. So that's the basic idea. Okay, so just to review where we've got so far, formal system is digital, self-contained, and decomposable into totally algorithmic processes. This means that it's multiply realizable, and furthermore, it cannot contain homunculi. Yeah? Okay. So the last part of this definition is automaticity. That was digitality. Everything we've done so far today was digitality. Automaticity is just that it does the thing itself. We talked about formal games where you need a person to play them. Automaticity is just a formal game that plays itself in some sense. It's just an automatic system. System which nobody has to manually crank out. So Alan, I think I told you earlier, Alan Turing wrote himself a chess playing program back before there were computers smart enough to use his program. So he had to like do it pen and paper by himself. So he's playing chess against the program that he wrote by just like going pen and paper and seeing what it would do next. And he successfully played against a game of chess against a chess playing program for which he did not have a computer. So that's a failure of automaticity in the sense that he had to work it out himself. In a properly automatic system, there's nobody who has to do that pen and paper work. It just does it. Okay. So that was it for the kind of defining what they mean by a computer sort of stuff, that is defining the sort of system that the good old-fashioned AI view thought that we are. Except for one little thing that I want to lead into by circling back to a little bit to psychology. So I talked about how nice a proposal this was, and it was a very nice proposal in its day. And one of the things that I hadn't sort of mentioned about what makes this nice is that there was this theory about psychology, advocated by, once again, Jerry Fodor, called the language of thought hypothesis. So this isn't an AI view, it's a view about how our minds work, how thinking works in our minds. And it goes like this. The argument was that every one of us comes with a language built in. It's not the language you speak, they called it mentalese. So every one of us has an innate language kind of like in which we learn to think originally. This is a language in the sense, it's a language like our language. So you've got like logical connections. You can say this, you can say X, or you can say not X. You can say X and Y, X or Y. So it's got logical structure. And the argument is, this is how your mind works. It works in terms of this internal language that you've got built in from birth. And then when you learn your language or languages, what you're doing is just learning how to translate between mentalese and the spoken language, basically. Some of the evidence for this was supposed to be just how quickly we acquire language. So Jerry Fodor is a student of the very famous Noam Chomsky. So Noam Chomsky argues for the innateness of language. He thinks that we've got like a built-in language center that has grammar kind of like hardwired into your brain. And part of the argument for this is supposed to be how quickly children pick up language. So it's kind of astonishing how quickly children learn to use language. And their claim was they're doing it so quickly that they must have the hardware. You can't just be starting from nothing. They must have some language hardware built in. And basically the same argument goes for mental ease, the language of thought. Kids learn to reason so quickly, so fluidly, and furthermore, so similarly, that we all kind of learn how to reason together. We all learn that if I have X and Y, that I can infer X from that, and I can infer Y from that. And nobody does that differently. Like, there's not a lot of cross-cultural variation in doing basic logic. Like, we all do that kind of the same. So the claim is, the idea was that we have this language built in as a kind of part of our human heritage. This stuff, just as a quick alternative, like, some theorists have thought that the way that your mind represents things is in images. So there's somebody like David Hume. David Hume thought, when you have the thought picnic, what happens is there's an image of a picnic comes up in your mind. Notice the difference between thinking that the mind works in terms of images and works in terms of sentences. So I can form the sentence, there is no dog at this picnic. But what does that look like in terms of an image? It looks like a picnic with no dog at it. But that's the same image as there is no cat at this picnic. There is no elephant at this picnic. There is no warthog at this picnic. It's all the same image, right? So the sentence can do some things that the images can't, like represent negation. Furthermore, for any sentence that you can think the negation of it. So the goat is on the mountain, you can think the goat is not on the mountain. Whereas it's hard to think about the negation of a picture, right? What's the negation of this? I don't even know what that means. Like, it's a question that I don't even know how to answer. Like, I don't know what that would mean to think about the negation of a picture or the negation of a map. Whereas the negation of any sentence is a self-sentence. Right? The conjunction of two sentences is always a sentence. You could say, the cat is on the mat and the goat is on the mountain. Those two things put together are still a sentence. Whereas the conjunction of two pictures, I don't know what that is, right? I don't know how to conjoin them. So, yeah.
Well, I mean, couldn't it be that, like, pictures are like how we understand, like, singular items or objects. Versus, I mean, if you look at a sentence, so even if there is negation, to understand it, you have to know what a picture is.
Right. So it's how we use categories or something like that. Yeah. So I think it's, that makes sense. That's possible. I suppose you could picture like categories. It's hard to picture a category of things, isn't it? Yeah. Do you know there are some people that can't form mental images? There are some people, and they're usually surprised to hear that other people can form mental images. They're like, they think they when you hear the phrase like picture an apple to yourself, they think it's just an elaborate metaphor. Whereas most of us have some kind of internal, like, I have a feeling when I'm trying to picture an apple, it's like semi-seeing it, but in my head. And there's some people who just don't have that. And the fact that they're surprised about this, they get through most of their life without even knowing that there's a difference between them and other people, suggests to me at least that that's not our primary mode of thinking in images. It's certainly something that most people can do, but you can get through life pretty well without having that. Like, to the point where you have no idea that other people are doing it on a regular basis. So this is just by way of contrasting the language of thought hypothesis with something else. David Hume thought, the old school philosopher thought, the structure of mental representation is pictures or maps or something like that. Jerry Fodor's arguing, no, the structure of mental representation is sentences. And that makes a really nice, so this language of thought thing was a theory in cognitive psychology. Around the same time, the computational theory of mind was going on, and these things, two things, fit together really nicely. So not all languages are formal languages, of course. So I'm speaking English right now. English is not a formal language. It's not a formal language in the sense that not all of its words have clear definitions. It's contextually sensitive and all that stuff. Formal languages like logic and math and computer programming are quite different than normal language, but they're a type of language. Not all formal systems are language-like in that sense. So if you've got a chess playing program, it's not necessarily thinking to itself in sentences, but you can have these two things together. So you've got a formal system manipulating sentence-like tokens, like tokens that are structured like a language. And then you get this, that's basically the classic picture of cognition in good old-fashioned AI era cognitive science. That the mind is a symbol manipulator, the symbols that it's manipulating are structured like sentences, and then thinking is just like doing logic on sentences. That's what your mind fundamentally is, according to this picture, is a symbol manipulator doing logical manipulations on symbols that are structured like sentences. That's kind of the core of the picture. Okay. So here's where it gets a bit sticky, however. There's one final element in Haugelin's definition of a computer. He said it's an interpreted automatic formal system. Interpreted. And what he means by that is that the symbols, the tokens that they're manipulating, the system is manipulating, are supposed to have meaning. They're supposed to stand for something in some important way. They have to have significance or something like that. And that's a tricky one. We'll see. It's a tricky one to pin down. So I hope for most of this lecture you were kind of going, yeah, very clear, that's fine, yeah. Now we've gotten to something that's a bit messier and harder to deal with. So recall this Descartes-Hobbes debate. So Hobbes says, you know, we're just meat machines, we're just crunching through symbol manipulations. And Descartes says, yeah, but that doesn't make you a reasoner. If you're not thinking about the meaning of what you're saying, the truth or falsity of it, you're not a reasoner. You're just a meat machine. I'm a reasoner. I don't know about you, Hobbes, but this is a necessary element to making mere token manipulations into symbol manipulation. So let's call something a token if it's just an element in a formal system. Let's call it a symbol if it means something. So what we need are symbols that mean things for it to be interpreted. And this is trickier. It's trickier to even say when we've achieved it. It's trickier to take something that can manipulate symbols in a seemingly intelligent way and say whether it's in fact reasoning or not. So people were pretty optimistic about this good old-fashioned AI project. I mean, really optimistic. And I think it's largely because they didn't take seriously enough this question of interpretation. They didn't take seriously enough Descartes' challenges that said, hey, what is meaning, what is it really? Let me briefly offer you some fun little quotes from the history of AI. So this is from 1955, proposal for the Dartmouth Summer Research Project. And some of the biggest names in AI are here. So John McCarthy, Marvin Minsky, Nathaniel Rochester, I don't know that guy, but Claude Shannon, as in Shannon Information. So they say, we propose that a 2-month, 10-man study of artificial intelligence be carried out during the summer of 1956 at Dartmouth College. The study is to proceed on the basis of the conjecture that every aspect of learning or any other feature of intelligence can in principle be so precisely described that a machine can be made to simulate it. An attempt will be made to find out how machines use language, form abstractions and concepts, solve kinds of problems now reserved for humans, and improve themselves. We think that a significant advance can be made in one or more of these problems if a carefully selected group of scientists work on it together for a summer. This is in 1955. So, you know, optimistic, very optimistic. And I would argue that this is the kind of optimism that you can generate if what you think thinking really is just doing formal manipulations on tokens. If you, as far as you know, just formally manipulating sentences according to logical rules is the core and beating heart of human intelligence, then you can, in 1955, believe something like this. And I promise you, I'm not trying to make fun of these people who made much larger contributions to the sum of human knowledge than I will ever make. These are very, very smart people who did make titanic contributions. Part of the contribution that they made was precisely to fail. It was precisely to fail. By trying to build such a thing and then failing, what they revealed is basically all the stuff that we talked about for the first half of the semester, which was the ways in which human-level intelligence outstrips just the logical manipulation of symbols. We are so much more than mere logic-deducing machines, and that was basically the argument that I spent all of the psychology section making to you, that we care about, not only do we need, like, do we happen to care about the symbols we're manipulating, we need to care about them if we're gonna be human-level intelligences. That was the claim. And I can easily see how that would not have been obvious before they tried to build an artificial intelligence. It was only by trying to build one and seeing the ways in which it fell short that it became clear that we are more than just mere symbol manipulators, or mere token manipulators, that we have to have actual symbols that we actually understand, and that understanding is something more than just getting the right answer. Just a couple more examples. So here's Herbert Simon. This is Simon from the Simon and Kaplan, as well as the Newell and Simon. So this is that guy. So in 1956, he says, machines will be capable within 20 years of doing any work that what man can do. I think it's supposed to be that man can do. Machines will be capable within 20 years of doing any work that man can do. 1956. Very optimistic. Marvin Minsky, 1967. Within a generation, the problem of creating artificial intelligence will be substantially solved. It's always about 20 years in advance. Actually, this is the same Minsky from the original quote. So in this quote, he says they think it'll take a summer. 10 years later, he thinks it'll take a generation. So we're getting there. We're getting there. Okay. But again, I'm really not making fun of these guys. I'm just trying to give you a little bit of historical background on how people thought this was gonna go when they first started it. And at least partly it was because the kind of people who were doing this AI research were the kind of people who spent all day indoors doing derivations of things, doing math and logic problems. And for them, that was the paragon of human intelligence. And if you could do that, of course you could do all of that other boring stuff, like keeping yourself alive and like preparing a home for yourself and doing all of that stuff, right? The hard part was math, logic, chess. And if you can figure that out, then all this other stuff will just sort of tumble out easily and straightforwardly. Caring about the universe, that'll just sort of be a byproduct somewhere along the way. Okay, so that turns out, I hope I've made the case for you at some length that that's not true, right? That's not what we're like, that's not what human level intelligence is like. Okay, so we need to think for a little while about this question of interpretation. The question of things being not just tokens in a formal system, but things that mean something to you. And I would like to introduce you to, I think, possibly my favorite robot. So I would like to introduce you to Shaky the Robot. And this is kind of a nice example of the good old-fashioned AI approach. So this is a project put on by Stanford, and they tried to bring together a bunch of independent research projects and kind of like meld them together into one unified guy. So they had visual, like he's got a couple of cameras on him so he can see and he can do basic object recognition. He can map things, he can plan for the future. So Shaky's got a bunch of like the most advanced AI processes at the time in the 70s and put all together in one package. And I want you to think about this question. Is shaky reasoning? So in the press materials for shaky, like Time Magazine calls him a reasoner. Whoever calls it a him, which I'm probably gonna do this a bunch. I'm probably gonna gender this robot. I promise you it has no genitals. All the materials gender it a male. They describe it as planning and having vision and doing all of these things that are like reasoning, proper reasoning. So let me show you a short and extremely adorable video about Shaky from the 70s, just to kind of prime your intuition. And throughout this, what I'd like you to be thinking about is Shaky reasoning? Does Shaky think, even in a simple way? Okay, so.
At SRI, we are experimenting with a mobile robot. We call him Shaky. Our goal is to give Shaky some of the abilities associated with intelligence, abilities like planning and learning. Even though the tasks we give Shaky seem quite simple, the programs needed to plan and coordinate his activities are complex. The main purpose of our research is to learn how to design these programs so that robots can be employed in a variety of tasks, ranging from space exploration to industrial automation. Shaky operates in this experimental environment of rooms, doorways, and simple objects. The top lens belongs to Shaky's television camera. He uses it to obtain visual information about his own location or about other objects. These walls were made high enough so that Shaky cannot see over them with his television camera. Shaky uses these feelers, or cat whiskers, to tell him if he has bumped into anything. He can push objects with this push bar. The programs controlling Shaky reside in a large PDP-10 computer and occupy over 300,000 36-bit words of storage. Shaky communicates with the computer over a radio link. We use a teletype to give instructions to the computer programs that control Shaky. Shaky reports back to us using the teletype and the cathode ray tube display. An executive program handles communication between the experimenter and the robot system. Shaky's movements are directly controlled by a set of low-level action programs. These programs convert orders such as roll 2.1 feet into appropriate commands to circuits on the vehicle that control Shaky's motors. Two other examples of low-level actions are pan and tilt. The low-level actions provide some of the building blocks for more complicated and powerful programs called intermediate-level actions. One such action is go-to. Go-to plans and executes a route to a named goal location, marked with a cross here, circumventing obstacles if need be. the go-to program plans a route by first computing whether any obstacles lie in a direct path. If so, points near the obstacle are set up as sub-goals. After Shaky computes a route, he traverses it to the goal. Another intermediate level action pushes a named object, box 1 in this example, to a location specified by a pair of coordinates. A feature of the intermediate level actions is their ability to recover from unforeseen accidents. Our gremlin, Charlie, symbolizes an agent of change unknown to Shaky. Shaky's sensors tell him that the box has slipped off the push bar, but his cat whiskers tell him where the box is, so he can get behind it and resume pushing.
Okay. So that's the basic idea. The really important question is, did that guy own the cape and cowl, or did he buy it specifically for the video? I think he owned it. I think that was just part of his repertoire. Okay, so that's Shaky the robot. I really like Shaky. So you heard the language that we used to describe Shaky. Shaky plans, Shaky intends, Shaky pushes, Shaky's doing these actions, right? So it's a nice example because it brings together a bunch of stuff that we've talked about. We saw just there there's the primitive algorithms that is like roll your wheels. That's a totally algorithmic process. You just roll the wheels, no intelligence involved. But then there's intermediate level ones where they have to do stuff like planning, and they very specifically make use of Newell and Simon's means ends heuristic. And what Shaky's doing is kind of logical stuff. So like Shaky's, let me show you a little bit of it. This stuff should be actually fairly familiar because it's stuff that we've talked about. So Shaky uses what was called the STRIPS architecture to plan actions. STRIPS broke plans into initial state, specification of the goal state, and a set of actions that could be used to get from the goal, from the initial state to the goal state. And furthermore, if something blocks them from using an action he wants to use, you can do intermediate sub-goals so that you can get closer to your goal. This is very much the means ends heuristic from Newell and Simon. Right? Let me just show you, just to kind of prime your intuition here, show you some of the coding. So this is the kind of stuff that the STRIPS architecture would have in it. So your initial state tells you that you're at point A, you're low down, and there are bananas, there's a box at point C and some bananas at point B. This is one of the like examples of intelligence that they use as a model, right? So if you present a monkey with the following situation, they will figure it out. There's bananas up high, but there's a box that they could push under the bananas to get them. The monkey will figure that out. That's something that a monkey perfectly capable of working out. And they're trying to build the level of intelligence into Shaky, who would let Shaky do that too. So basic representations of location, like are you high or low, and what you're trying to do. And then there's a bunch of sort of intermediate level subroutines. So you can move from X to Y. So preconditions, you're at X and you're low. Post conditions, you're at Y, you're not at X. You can climb up on the box. That is to say, if you're where the box is and you're low down, you can go up on the box. Shaky obviously can't do that. You saw some like, they had some big plans for Shaky. You saw some like ramps and stuff. So Shaky could identify the ramps. I think they were eventually hoping to make him able to like go up the ramp. So that's something they were programming for, but obviously the ramp was like at a 75 degree angle, so they couldn't do that. But like, so here's the kind of things. Move monkey and box from X to Y. Like, it understands the preconditions, so if you meet the preconditions, then you can get to the post conditions. And it's just doing logical inferences. So Shaky's doing basically propositional logic. Predicate logic. Plugging in locations into these functions, doing deductions about how do you get from your initial state to your goal state.
So Shaky's doing reason. Saw that part of that reasoning was based on a picture of the environment that Shaky's at least partially constructing for itself via the kind of sensors, the cat whisker sensors, and also basic, like pretty crude, but like for real object recognition. So later in the video, they go on about how you can use this video feed to do edge detection and use that edge detection to figure out where boxes are. So Shaky's at least capable of looking around the environment, identifying where objects are, building plans based on that identification. Now, does that make Shaky an intelligent? Is Shaky reasoning about its environment? Is the question.
Somewhat.
Sort of. Yeah. Yeah.
It's not like a sunflower where it's reacting to its environment instead of reasoning about it.
Okay. Okay. So. We got no strong endorsements for Shaky as a full-blown intelligent agent so far, which is sounds fair. And we've got a medium strength endorsement and a not really medium. Well, so in some sense, people are starting to think about plants as maybe having a kind of intelligence because they do this reactive thing, right? Because they act as though they are aware of their environment. That's good enough for some people. And then the follow-up question is, if Shaky's not an intelligent agent, what would you need to add to take Shaky from being unintelligent to intelligent? Yeah.
So it has its own goals.
Its own goals. Interesting. Interesting. So it comes up with its own goals. Would it be okay if you just came up with them at random? Is that enough?
I guess.
Yeah? Just randomly generate goals, push blocks to this location. And now he's intelligent. Yeah.
The goals would have to be like dependent on like situations.
So you gotta come up with the right kind of goals.
Yeah.
Interesting. I mean that certainly sounds both of those sound intelligent. They sound like okay. Yeah.
Actually know. Yeah.
I agree with you. It's hard to say what we mean by actually know.
So there's a difference, I would say.
Yeah.
Between reacting to your environment, pushing boxes,
yeah.
And understanding, A, that this is a box, so that you're interacting with your environment,
yeah.
And that you're pushing. Like there's
right.
An idea, there's a boundary, you're doing, and
yeah.
you understand, I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, it's hard to cash out, right? It's hard to say what would make it the case that. So if I put a sentence into Shaky's head, I am Shaky. Like it's got that sentence in there, but does it understand the sentence? Yeah.
Maybe he has the ability to like manipulate the characteristics it's using, change its behavior in response to its goals, like. If it needs to get to a place, it's just using that characteristic, a simple one.
Yeah.
But if it can change that or learn new ones and swap between them, I'd say that's kind of intelligent.
So this is related to produce your goals in a contextual fashion thought. Yeah.
It should have at least one goal in order to be intelligent.
Would you have one in mind or?
I don't know. To me, it's like thinking about ourselves as humans.
Yeah.
The goal is to, let's say, pass on the gene. So in a sense, you don't die. You die physically, but genetically, code.
I have
passed on. I mean, from the evolutionary perspective, that's what you're given. You don't really know how you're gonna achieve it at the instance that you're born, I think. But moving forward towards that goal, you figure out different heuristics and. So from that perspective, I said maybe it's somewhat intelligent because at least it's externally given a goal. But on the way to achieving that goal, even with one heuristic, it's based on that basic algorithmic operations, you can come up with something.
So I'm happy with the idea that having built-in goals and goals like. Keep yourself alive, maybe, is a good one.
Yeah.
The just spreading your genes thing, like, If that was it, then the best way of living your life would be as a man, travel the world, make just enough money to travel the world going from sperm bank to sperm bank, and just make as many donations as you possibly can. You should lie on all of the forms, tell them you're a Harvard graduate, you're an Olympic athlete. People tell me this all the time, like, evolution gives us the goal of spreading our genes, and then I give them this scenario and they're like, no, I don't really want to do that. So having goals, having self-generated goals seems to be a common theme. Is that? Yeah.
I don't know if that's enough though, because would Shaky then, while Shaky is generating a goal, or while he doesn't have a goal, would it then be unintelligent even to have the capability, or just having the capability enough? Like, if it's currently goalless.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think, so there's also the question, does Shaky understand the goal? Like, does it have an appreciation of what the, so currently Shaky's capable of having goals, right? Push box to location, da da da, right? That's in some sense a goal state, and it's a goal that he can dynamically, adaptively move himself towards. Keep using this him, but you know what I mean? So got goals, and then there's like, does he need to make his own goals? What does his goals have to relate to? Yeah.
I think what we might be missing is the fact that even us as people, biological beings, are evolutionary speaking.
Yep.
It's not really completely true to say that we're making our own goal. I mean, not as soon as we're born right away, we think, oh, I gotta go to this customer.
It does not work that way.
Exactly. And yep. I think that just the same thing with Shady. Yep. It's the only difference is that we can't see who's at our console telling us, oh, you need to live your life, and you need to have a family. Or school. It's just that the difference is we're not the same way where we can see who's making that like little program for us, but I think having our own goals and for Chase to have our own goals is not completely fair argument considering, well, it's not like we've had our own goals our entire life.
And you wouldn't want to, I mean, I think you wouldn't want to have just random goals, right?
Exactly.
You wouldn't just want to be like, I want to climb a mountain and play a flute on it, and that's my whole life thing. You don't want to just pick goals at random. You want your goals to somehow be related to who you are as a person.
Yeah.
Although I think we can also say with some confidence that our goals are not simply programmed, because evolution, like lots of people want to write a novel. I want to write a novel. There's no evolutionary pressure for writing novels. Like, novels didn't exist when we were kind of developing. So we know that many of our goals cannot be the result of evolution.
Right, of course.
So something, but I nonetheless don't want my goals to just be totally random. I want them to be somehow be related to me.
I think a good indication that JD is intelligent would be that its ability to recognize an object and at the same time ignore it. So if, for example, telescopic eye.
It's got like a video camera.
If the camera had the ability to ignore objects in the room.
Interesting.
I think that would be a really good sign, because if you do a lot of things,
interesting,
have the ability to focus attention. Its perception would be geared towards some kind of goal almost implicitly, because it's ignoring information.
That's right.
It's a very good sense that it's ignoring to focus. But it can't be that. But the reason it has to be able to recognize an object is because if it just couldn't see the object,
that's right. Interesting. So we're gonna explore that later in the course, almost at the end of the course, in terms of consciousness. So we might even be talking about what it would mean for Shaky to be conscious. It would be something like to have a perspective that's determined by what you care about, or something like that. Yeah. Maybe a more specific question we can ask is, what would it take for the symbols that Shaky's manipulating to have meaning? Be symbols rather than tokens. So we saw a token, he's got a, it has a, box. So yeah, if there's a box at location blank. Now, does that mean, does that have the meaning of box for Shaky? And if not, why?
Maybe it would have meaning, like if it had more properties about it and maybe like in ways that are specifically derived from heuristics, exactly. Like it's that box, okay, I can push around, but I can also use it to push other things, or I can go on top of it, or something.
So a richer representation of box. Yeah. Like currently, Shaky gets the idea that there's a box somewhere by noticing that there are some edges, and then wherever there's the appropriate shape of edges, they're like, that's where a box is, or at least that token will be filled in at that location. So maybe if Shaky had like, a box is something that's made out of wood or cardboard. A box is something that you can store things in. A box is something that Amazon ships me stuff in. Not that Amazon exists back then, but so a richer representation or something like that, and then you wanted that to be related to the heuristics that he's
so it can manipulate it in more ways than are like strictly prescribed.
Right. Interesting. Okay, so more than strictly prescribed. So this is we're getting at the idea that to understand what you're seeing is not just to appropriate it in one way, but to have a multiple angles of approach, some of which were not programmed into you. That, by the way, is how I mark your tests. If you understand something, that means you can kind of turn it around in your head in ways that I did not pre-program into you. So that's one of my, I'm literally trying to do this with you as well, right? I am trying to ascertain whether there are intelligent processes going on in you, or whether you are a mere reproducer of words that were that I spat at you, right? So I'm also, when I'm trying to think about whether Shaky's intelligent, I'm using a lot of strategies on you as well. Like obviously you're intelligent, but are you applying that intelligence to this specific course or not? I'm using some of these strategies, like can you do this flexibly, right? And it might be helpful to think about Shaky in these terms, like how would you, based on what would you ascertain that this thing is an intelligent agent? And it's things, we're saying things like having its own perspective, having its own goals, self-generating goals that are in some sense relevant to it, right? Being able to manipulate your representations in unexpected ways that are context sensitive. Like there's an incredible tangle of things that you might require before you're willing to say that this weird robot is an intelligent agent. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, to go back on the other slide, the fact that like you had like box dot or whatever, it would be interesting to see if JP felt that being this like the language was written for it.
Yep.
If it, you know, kind of started off in the center of the room,
right.
Notice this,
right.
And it doesn't have to be box. It can literally go with any other like symbol to represent that as as an object, so long as you can recall that that's there, you almost get a sense that it's shaky, right?
Yeah.
And that would also be kind of a key that.
Right. So we can ask ourselves, how much of what Shaky's got is built-in algorithms and how much was self-generated? So, like, Shaky's got three kinds of objects that it's capable of recognizing. Walls, boxes, and ramps. That's it. Those are the three categories in Shaky's universe, and they came pre-programmed. Shaky did not have to work out that there are three kinds of things in the universe. Shaky's not capable of learning a fourth type of thing in the universe unless you program it into Shaky, right? So this notion that maybe what's crucial to intelligence is not just having the logical structure, but being capable of expanding it and developing it in a context-sensitive way. That's very interesting. And as we go along, so this is going to be one of the things that is the downfall of the good old-fashioned AI project. The reason why Shaky did not turn into an intelligent ambulatory robot is that they didn't include this development. One of the reasons is that they didn't include the development of intelligence as crucial to intelligence. Again, these are guys sitting in rooms solving logic problems. For them, the rules are pre-given. The relevant operations are pre-given. The problem is just getting from the goal state from the initial state to the goal state by following the rules. And all of the stuff that we're talking about is like kind of goes beyond the type of tasks that they're used to dealing with. Yeah.
So you say you get curious?
Interesting. Curious. Interesting. I hadn't thought of that, but now I do. Yeah. Yeah. Do you think you'd have to be curious in order to be intelligent? The philosopher of biology Hans Jonas says something like this. So he distinguishes basically plants, animals, and humans. Plants don't have a horizon exactly. They don't have to go anywhere. They just sit there and metabolize. Animals have a horizon. So the perspective that they have on the world is constantly changing. And there's always something that's outside of their ability to represent it. And then humans are the ones that know that our representation is incomplete. So, or at least sentient beings. We know, so Shaky's got a picture of the world. Shaky's not really trying to like bust out of it. And Hans Jonas says, this is what's characteristic of our way of being in the world, is that we are aware that our picture, our representation of the world is limited, and we are constantly driven to go beyond the limits that were presented to us. So that would be, Hans Jonas, I think, would agree with you and say, yeah, curiosity is driven by the idea that you know that you don't know everything. And you are constantly driven to go beyond your picture of reality because of this sort of like almost painful awareness of the limits of your own perspective. Yeah. Okay. So we'll come back to this. We'll discuss this more about like what would it mean for a pure symbol manipulator like Shaky to understand its world and to be intelligent. I think it's fairly clear. I mean, my bias is that Shaky's not an intelligent agent. And Shaky doesn't understand the meaning of the symbols that it's manipulating, right? Any more than your laptop understands the meaning of the symbols that it's manipulating. Despite the fact that it's connected to the world in the right ways, like it's got sensors, it's got physical sensors that are connecting it to the world. It's got the ability to categorize, it's got the ability to plan. None of that seems to be enough. There seems to be this requirement coming out of our discussion that it be flexible in the right ways, that it be dynamic, that it be in some sense self-organizing. And that's precisely where our discussion of, that's precisely where the history of AI went, actually. So all arguments aside, all kind of theoretical arguments aside, the project that saw intelligence as the mere logical manipulation of sentences simply didn't pan out. Despite all of the optimism that I described to you just a little while ago, it just didn't work out. And the direction in which sort of hopes started to come up over the horizon was where systems started organizing themselves. And they were more dynamic, they were more flexible, they were less kind of rigidly logical than Shaky. So as a matter of historical fact, that's where AI research has gone. And I think that you can see, hopefully, at least some kind of arguments for why that might be a good way for it to have gone. The logical approach to intelligence has got some pretty deep limits. And we're just going to, for the next couple of weeks, we're going to watch that play out in some sense. We're going to talk about what it means for a symbol to be, for a token to be a symbol, and to try to really confront Descartes' problem of when is symbol manipulation genuine thinking. That's where we're going to go next. Okay, it is very cold in here. Let's call it a day, shall we? We'll come back and talk about this on Thursday when it will hopefully be room temperature.